Hello everyone. So continuing again on root locus thing, we just left with couple of rules. So first one was angle of departure for open loop code. And why is this important to compute? So in one of our earlier example, we have seen that we have pole at origin, one pole at j 2 omega, another was at minus j 2 omega. So one guy was going to infinity on real axis, there was asymptote angles like this. So this guy moves like this and this guy was moving like this. So who decided, right, how does this guy go? Why does it doesn't go like some steep angle and like this or something like this? Well, say who decided, what is there anything that will tell us which direction I should move, right? So this is decided by something called as angle of departure. Or which direction I should go. So angle of departure, the formula says that following is phi p is equals to plus minus 2 q plus 1 180 degree plus phi. So for an open loop pole, let's see, I'm just looking at one pole under consideration. Is again it should satisfy the angle criteria, right? One plus, we always looking at just one thing, 1 plus kgs hs is equals to 0. So all this criteria, all we just try to satisfy criteria, right? Nothing else, just that, you know, the magnitude criteria and the angle criteria, as simple as that. So the angle of departure is again the same angle criteria. So little modification with plus phi. Okay, so what is this phi? So I am interested in some pole and this phi is the angle, net angle contribution by this pole by all other open loop poles and zero. Say I'm interested in some pole, okay? Then now this is for poles, right? I go from pole to zero, so I arrive at zero. So which direction do I arrive, or do I arrive along axis and I just do some circular behavior or whatever? How do I arrive? That also important, right? So the angle arrival is again defined similarly. So I just, let's try to understand what this means and say draw a little picture here. So let's say I have 6 poles and 1 0. Okay, so if I just draw it, it is like I'm having 1, 2, 3, 4 poles on origin, 2 on plane, I'm having 1, 0, this is P1, this is P2, this is P3, this is P4, this is P5, this is P6, okay? And let's say I just take a point very close here, this one, S0. Now this S not lie on root locus, it must for sure satisfy the angle criteria, okay? So now this this is very close, right? So let's see, I just draw these angles. This is phi 4, this angle is phi 3, this is phi 2, this is phi 1, the angle with this is 5 6, and the angle with this point is 5 p. Okay, and the angle with 0 is, I just take angle with 0 as 5. This angle is 5. Okay, so this guy actually moving in which direction? I am interested in that. So this is angle 5 P, the pole which I am interested in. So there is phi's in. So sum of all these angles should again be multiple of 180 degree. So what is this? How the angle criteria look like? The angle 0 is just phi. Then I have angle of all the poles phi 1, phi 2, phi 3, phi 4, phi P, phi 6. This again should be equals to 180 degree. So 5 minus 5 1 plus 5 2 plus 5 3 plus 5 4 plus 5 p plus 5 6 should be equals to plus minus 180 degree blah blah blah. Okay, now I am interested in this angle, right? This guy, this little angle, 5p. And it should tell me where I will go. So therefore, I just, you know, substitute this 5p or even 5p, whatever is simply. It will be 5p will be plus minus 180 degree 2q plus 1 minus whatever angles are there. Okay? Sorry, plus. Bring all the angles over here, and this will be my phi angle in this equation. Okay, so I will just net contribution of all the poles and zeros for P is almost 0 since the P5 is very close to S0. Okay, so the angle contribution is like this. I will just clear it once for that. Okay. So this is phi angle, net contribution. Okay, pz minus p minus all the poles except p5. So this is net contribution for S0. This is not equals to 0. Okay. So p net is p5 minus these 5, net contribution. Okay, so if I just see next, this is how I get it. It's a kind of straightforward to look, right? Again, because you know S0 is very close to a pole P5, so well, that particular angle contribution will comes for zeros, and you know this, then other poles and angle contribution by other poles would satisfy the angle criteria. Okay, so where I'm not moving, I'm just at the pole, and condition as S0 goes to P5. But S0 is very close to P5. How do I compute the angle? Well, this is just this P5, and in last slide also we have seen P5 formula. That's how we will calculate it. Okay, now next. So we do an example. It's case the root locus for a unity feedback system with open loop transfer function again. Okay, so we have complex conjugate poles 1, 0 at minus 1. Number of poles is 2, number of 0 is 1, hence the number of branches is 2. And if I just see how the plot looks, I will just plot your rough sketch of it. So here I am having 1, 0, my poles are at plus j3 minus 2 minus j3. Okay, so I just want to see, you know, which direction I should move. Okay, if two branches originated at k equals to 0 and another k equals to 0, one will go to this 0 and another will go to infinite. Okay, so I just want to see how, you know, which direction this will move and this will move. But before that, let me do first rule, right? Which point is on real axis. So I know when I start at k equals to 0. Now just look at this point. There is nothing here. Then look at this point here, right? So from here, if I go to left minus 1, there is just one pole, odd number. And then I go again here, there is again an odd number, 3. Okay, so there is just one 0 odd number. Then again here, it's 3. So we can neglect these complex poles for counting because they always are in conjugate pair. So if even here I am having even before this guy, then there always will even after this guy. If it is an odd here, there will be odd here. So at least I know that the entire guy on real exists. Okay, so this is the part of root locus. This entire thing is on root locus from the left of minus 1. Okay, so the two branches of root locus originated from both the poles when k is equals to 0. Since m is equals to 1, so one will move towards minus 0 and another will move towards infinity. And since all the points are between minus infinity and minus, lies on root locus, since the number of poles on the right is odd. Okay, so again I do all the basic computation that will, there is one guy which goes to infinity. What is the angle in which that guy goes to infinity? Well, that angle is 180 degree. And it is just very straightforward to compare n minus m is equals to 1. So phi will be 180. If I put the value of k 0, it will be 180 degree. Okay. And this guy will go here. This guy will come here. So these both will meet somewhere on real axis. So how I can calculate that? For calculation of that, I have dk by ds is equals to 0. And the solution would be this minus 4.16 and 2.26. So I do not really interested in this guy, right? This point doesn't really lies on root locus. I'm not ignoring because it's an unstable, right, reason. I'm just ignoring because the root locus tells me that all this part of real axis is part of root locus. But if I 2.26 is over here, so it's not a part of root locus. Whereas minus 4.16 is on this side, so it's a part of root locus. Okay. So minus 4.16 is my breakaway point. Now I just go now to compute the angle of departure. Departure from this side and departure from this side, right? So then I just formulate phi p. I'm looking at this guy plus minus 180 degree plus the contribution of other two guys. And if I am computing phi for this guy, and it would be phi would be angle of contribution by other two remaining two guys. So I can just compute this kind of straightforward to check phi for this guy first. So it will be 198.46, and phi for this guy it would be 161.57. So I just now know that I am just in this angle. I am having some angle of 190 and this angle will be 161. Okay, so these are your angle of departures. And if I know that if they are moving in this direction and this is moving in this direction, they will meet at minus 4.16, right? So locus will start here, the locus will start here. Then it will come here, one will go on this side, another will go to infinity. Okay. And this angle is 198.46 and this is 161.57. So this is how angle tell me why, how it's behave. Okay. So this is my one branch, this is my another branch. One is going to 0, another is going to infinity. Okay. There is something not very surprising this rule. How do I know if my root intersect with imaginary axis? Well, when I hit imaginary axis, say I have a root locus which is I'll just have it. It is like this. I have three guys. Say one is here, one is here, another is here. I say, well, this guy, I'm just doing an approximate like, so this guy would be something like right here. So there is possibility that this is the part of root locus, because here it's odd, here it's odd. If I want this side, it's even number of poles, so that's not the part of root locus. This is the part of my root locus. Okay, so this will move towards infinity. This will, these both will come on this side, and they come like this. So these are k equals to 0, k equals to 0, k equals to 0, and I can see that after some value they are actually going this side. So they are going in unstable region. So can I really compute this value when it comes becomes in unstable? Another example where my poles were like this, like one is here, one is here, one is here, so one is like this, another was going like this. So for any value of k greater than 0, it was always unstable, right? So that was not difficult to compute. So how do I compute, how do I handle these conditions? So well, I know something all Roth Harvard's criteria, right? So the intersection of pole root locus with imaginary axis can easily be determined by Routh's criteria. Just to see how can you, so we had some problem where we can compute stability with respect to a parameter. If k was between like some number, k is between this number and that number, the system is stable. If k is greater than this number, the system is unstable. Also, then the loop gain k has gain k at any point of root locus is just like given by this. So I think this had, we had even discussed in one of our earlier slide, what gives the point k, how do I find the value of k. Okay, so give a point on root locus, how I find the gain k at that point. Well, this is just simple, there is nothing special here. Of course, now if you would do on MATLAB, you just move the cursor, it will actually tells you the value of k at each point. But here, does it comes from, where does it comes from? That's from something here. Okay, just do another example. So we have g equals to k by s square plus 8s plus 32. So I have a pole at origin, two poles which are complex conjugate, and then another pole at zero. So if I draw it, it will be something like one is at origin, another two at minus 4 plus j 4 minus 4 plus j 4. Okay, so I have a pole at origin and I have two poles here. So the number of branches is 3. Since there is no zero, all of these things will go to infinity. Okay, because there is no zero. So which point on real axis lie on root locus? So the point between minus infinity to zero is the part of root locus, since there is sum of poles to the right, poles and zeros to the right is odd. So this is part of my root locus. And in the usual process of finding how the root locus or how the root proceed to infinity, there will be angle of asymptote at 60, 180 and 300 with standard formula. Okay. Now, the centroid point of these asymptote will be minus 2.667. So, if you will see, my centroid is somewhere here. This is my centroid, this is my one pole, this is another pole. Centroid is somewhere here. This is 1 plus J4 minus 4 minus j 4 is answer 0. So the breakaway point, we'll just look at dk by ds. So it will be this point. I will first find the value of k, then I will calculate dk by ds, and it is minus 8 somewhere here. So I could actually see from here that these points are very unlike to be on root locus, right? So I look at minus 8 plus minus plus j 4 under root 2. So I'm at somewhere here, right? Then what do my asymptote suggest is that I should have 60, 180 and 300. So which is at angle like over here? Okay, so it shows that I should actually be moving towards the asymptotes. So somewhere in this direction and this direction. So there is no way that I could reach these points. These point 8. There's no way that I should reach these points. Okay. Based on the location of poles, so the and centroid point and asymptote. So for sure that even though dk by ds is equals to 0, give me a solution, these points will not lie on root locus. You should also test this by angle and magnitude criteria. Now I am looking at angle of departure. So angle of departure would be computed by this angle, okay, plus minus 180 degree, the angle made by this, the angle made by this, and the angle made by this, okay. Since these are moving in this direction, asymptotes are towards the right of imaginary axis. And there would be chance of these guys meeting at imaginary axis. So let's see if that is true. So I write, 1 second. I will move to next slide. So for the point of intersection with imaginary axis, I write down the characteristic equation. And then I draw the routes table. Okay. For this, my characteristic equation is S cube plus 8S square plus 32S plus K is equals to 0. Okay. So I have 8, 1, 32, 8, k, then this 256 minus k by 8 and then k. So what happened when does this guy goes to 0 and this guy goes to 0? So for the value of k equals to 256, so for the value of k equals to 256, I have entire row equals to 0. Now let's see how auxiliary equations look like. So I have 8s square plus 256, then I differentiate it. Sorry, this is my auxiliary equation. So where it will cross the imaginary axis, so this is somewhere here, plus minus j under root 32 is in the positive direction, so under root 32 in the negative direction. So this is, I will see with the help of diagram. So under root 32 is somewhere here and here in negative y. So this gives me lot of information now. If there is no breakaway point, the root locus will actually cross the imaginary axis and it would actually do it this way. An angle of departure is minus 45 and plus 45. So it will initially tends to move in this way. And this under root 32 on j-axis, and then it just go along asymptote this way. Similarly for this guy. Okay. So we saw few possibilities here, right? There is no breakaway point, even though dk by ds gives me a solution. Second is to explicitly compute the angle of departure, right? Also to see exact where the root locus meet my imaginary axis. And this where the routes table was very useful for that. So if I now want to have a problem where I said, well, what are the values of gain k for which the system is stable? So I will, well, for the value of gain k equals to 0 to 256, my system is stable. And for all other values, it might be unstable. It is k between 0 and 256, my system is stable. So I have a bit better understanding how now for relative stability in terms of gain k. So that's about it, this guy and these kind of straightforward, right? So you just keep on moving to the left until it reaches infinite, right? Very straightforward loop, root locus for this guy. To summarize this whole module about root locus plot, we have learned root construction root, then root locus technique. We also knew now does the system goes to stability, instability, and next we meet, we will do lots of thing on frequency response of system. Now we were interested in what happened when time goes to 0 to infinity or gain goes from 0 to infinity. We will see what happened with changing frequency. So that we'll do in the coming lectures. Okay, that's all for today's lecture. Thank you.